And I think that if we see, you know, the market shrinking, or we see, you know, less money, you know, coming into our pockets and prices going down, and we start to get anxious, the best way we can respond to that is not with a scarcity mindset, but with an abundance mindset.
Welcome to The Portfolio Life with Jeff Goins. I'm your host, Andy Traub. This is the show that helps you pursue work that actually matters, make a difference in the world with your art, and discover your true voice. Today's show is pretty informal, but at the same time, I promise it's informative. After Jeff and I discussed how we'll actually start the show, we talked about useful things like how to build a habit and why Amazon is quickly becoming the self-publishing author's bestest friend, especially with a very recent decision they've made about pre-ordering books. And lastly, we make two pretty bold predictions about the future of vocabulary and Dunkin' Donuts.
Okay, so let's do that then. Okay, I'll say something and then you say something. And
so
then
I'm Jeff Goins and this is A Portfolio Life.
Well, I'm Jeff Goins, but I'm going to go and then you're going to go.
Are you going to do it? Well, just go.
Yeah, okay. Welcome to The Portfolio Life. I'm Jeff Goins, and this is the show that helps you pursue work that matters, make a difference with your art, and discover your true voice.
And I'm Andy Traub, and on this episode, we're going to talk about one of Jeff's favorite books called Mastery by Robert Greene, some publishing news from Amazon about Kindle pre-ordering, and why writing habits are for pros.
Pros, P-R-O-S or P-R-O-S-E?
Oh, I see what you did there. See,
writing pun.
I just feel dumb right now because you made a pun that I didn't even know was a pun.
It's an unintentional pun. So on this show, you know, on this episode, we're going to try something different where we're going to try like an intentional format. And
well, we always had an intentional format.
Right.
We just had more. There's more.
There's going to be like specific segments. So Andy, this was your idea. Why don't you tell people... I think it'd be cool, you know, you came up with an alliterative naming sequence for the segments. Why don't you share what they are?
Yes, and that was a very good word by alliterative. I thought you were saying I couldn't read for a minute, but then you finished the word. It's alliterative, not illiterate.
You know what word I can't say very well, and it kind of sucks given what I do, is processor, word processor.
Yeah, I have heard you stumble on that before.
Yeah, like really badly, because I want to add like endless S's into
it. You
want to
keep going?
Word processor, like that's what I want to say. I don't know.
I thought
why.
You wanted to just keep going.
So whenever you hear me, if I ever do like an interview where I talk about like writing tools,
you'll say writing program.
Like I will either say like, well, like Microsoft Word, you know, but like not that. Or I'll say Word and then I'll pause and I'll go processor, because if I say it quickly, it sounds real natural, dude. It's bad news.
Processor. Oh.
Okay, so what is our process for the show?
Right, and the alliterative is that they all start with the same letter, just for those to clarify.
That's right.
Is that they all start with the letter P, and they are practical, personal growth, publishing, profound, and prediction. So do you want to talk about each section a little bit? Or should we just do them?
Let's just do them.
Do them practical. So let's talk about, this time we're going to talk about really practical writing tips, and this is... now I'm nervous. I'm going to say these things wrong because you are much more cultured than I am. Is apropos. This is apropos because of your post from today about writing habits, daily writing. So we're going to talk about writing habits. And I wanted to focus in on this phrase, and I think that you attribute it to Acuff, but something about discipline begets discipline.
Yeah, I don't know where I heard that first. I think John Acuff.
Let's give it to John.
John, well done. discipline begets discipline. And it's this idea that if you're struggling with discipline in one area, one of the best things that you could do is kind of amp up the discipline in another area of your life, which really fits, you know, the theme of the show, which is that, you know, the thing that you do is actually, it's a collection of things. It's a portfolio of things. And so whenever I'm struggling with, you know, discipline in one area of life, it's often accompanied by, you know, that same type of struggle in another area of life. For example, when I'm, you know, struggling with regularly exercising and going for runs and, you know, eating right, usually my writing is suffering. And the, you know, converse is also true, which is that if you are struggling to write every day, for example, or, you know, get up early or, you know, do something and you just can't break through, try kind of coming at it from another angle.
You could almost say like it's cheating, like pick something easier.
Yeah, pick something easier to kind of grow that discipline muscle. And then I think what you'll find is that it kind of crosses over. And I found that when I was starting to write every day, which was something that I heard writers talk about but never really did myself. And
Was that your easy one?
Writing wasn't the easy one. And this might, like, some people might not relate to this, but for me, it was easier to get up and run 5 miles than it was to get up and write 500 words. And so I didn't consciously do that. I started getting up every day and running, and I would come back and I would have all these endorphins, you know, firing, and I would sit down and I would write for an hour.
Come on, you feel like a champ when you do that. You're like,
yeah, totally.
How many people did I pass that were sitting on their couch? I ran by Andy's house 4 times and he was there, sitting there, eating donuts.
Yeah, that's right. You know? Yeah, I mean, so, you know, like, that, you know, the idea is if you're struggling with a certain area of your life, particularly with discipline, yeah, like you said, find an easier discipline, and what you'll see is there's this kind of natural crossover that happens. And I think this is the secret to making any skill effortless, which sounds like it's the same thing as easy, but it's not. What I mean by effortless is that it's not quite as difficult to begin as it used to begin. And this is true for, you know, any habit that you're creating. The first day is the hardest. You know, Andy, when you were building this discipline of getting up every morning, I'm sure day one was much harder than, you know, day 30.
Day one felt stupid. I mean, you feel stupid. You're like, what? Yeah. There's a reason no one else is awake right now, like in my town, you know,
right?
But then you realize there is a reason, and that is that they don't know the power of it. So let me give you some suggestions, not you, but you, Jeff, but you, the listener, of some easy things you could do to start to build a habit. Because what you want to start to believe about yourself is that you're a disciplined person. And the reality is you're not until you pick something, right? And so one that I like to do, and I go off and on with this, but like one of my favorite things to do in the world is drink Coca-Cola. Just drink a Coke, okay? Not Pepsi, but like Coke, okay? But I was drinking way too much when I got married, and so my wife kind of helped wean me off of it. But I just don't want to quit it. So what I do is I have like one a week, okay? But
it's like a reward?
Oh, yeah. I'm like a dog. I mean, it's like, honey, here's your Coke. But I love it. But like I feel so awesome when I have it, one, because it tastes good, but two, because I haven't had one all week.
Yeah.
Right? So like, but that's some people like, why don't you give it up altogether? Because I like my life. Right,
I like my Coke.
So, but some people say like that's not even discipline. I'm like, yeah, it is. You go from like drinking one or two a day to one a week. Like that's discipline. So my point is, that's an easy thing for me. Like it's easier, right, than saying I'm gonna start working out. So once I've done that one, then I can go to a different one.
Yeah. Well, and so what you're saying is basically, you know, so I hear you saying two things. I don't know if you meant to say this other thing. But,
oh, I did, but tell me what it is.
Well, you know, what you just said, which is, you know, like kind of start small with a habit and then, you know, kind of increase it from there. And what you're talking about is essentially, you know, abstinence, abstaining from something. But the flip side to that is reward yourself for your discipline.
Yeah.
Right? So, like, there are certain things that, you know, aren't necessarily bad, but just, you know, aren't great in excess. I think most things are that way. And so if you're trying to say no to something, it's better to not just say completely, you know, no to it, just a cut and dried no, but not right now, you know, so that you can say yes to it later. That, you know, includes most things that we consume, like everything from, I think, TV to, you know, Coke and cake. You know, it's like if you enjoy those things, but, you know, they can kind of run your life, then you kind of tell yourself, okay, I'm going to wait until I do this so that, you know, then I can get rewarded for the behavior.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think Neil Fiore, who writes about procrastination, he talks about this. He says that, you know, if you're trying to get something done, but you tend to procrastinate, like reward yourself. Give yourself
absolutely
small rewards. So if you're struggling to like write your book or get up early or whatever it is, like don't just like stay stuck in the discipline. Like once you do the thing, give yourself a small reward. And I think, you know, something happens in your brain where you associate that hard thing that you don't like doing with the reward, and it makes you want to do that thing.
Yeah, you don't run because running is fun usually. you might go, wow, it might surprise you that running is fun. You might get some, but like you run because of the finish line. Mm-hmm. Like cross country, like I never really got that, like because it's like you take so long to get to the win. I'm like, I want to do the 50-yard dash, you know, like just because I want that finish line sooner. So that's another way of looking at it is what are the small things you could do? Like, so what you told me something about, because I was asking you about starting to run, starting to train, but now I live in this climate where I can do that. You said something about you need to run like 12 miles or whatever. You told me to download some app and it said basically you need to run like 12 miles a week and you can do it in different chunks. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't like you've got to do them all right now and you've got to do it. So I liked that it gave you a parameter, like here's the goal. Mm-hmm. But it said, hey, do it in these little chunks here and there.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, you know, with running, I think I sent you a half marathon training regimen. And basically what you do is you run a few miles every day, depending on where, you know, whatever you can, you know, you start wherever you can start. And then there's one day a week where you keep pushing yourself, usually Saturday or, you know, some day where you can run, you know, an extra long segment. And so if you're training for a half marathon, that's the day that you're pushing up to, you know, the 12, 13 mile run eventually. Yeah. You're not doing that every day. You're doing that, you know, once a week and you just kind of start small. And every week you just kind of increase it by half a mile or a mile you know, until you're ready.
Yeah. So, you know, what could you do in your riding, right, to do that same thing? So mm-hmm. some people might say, I just don't have time. And I might go, yeah, maybe you don't have time right now. So what little bit of time could you do? I mean, you know, it's eat your lunch faster and then write. But so that post, just so folks know, is goinswriter.com/daily-writing. Let's talk about personal growth. You had mentioned a book by a different author, but I want to bring up Mastery because I heard it referenced in a different show I was listening to today. And I know that you're a big fan of that book by Robert Greene, and we'll have a link to this in the episode notes. But Mastery, first, can I just tell you, the cover kind of freaks me out a little bit.
Like all the triangles or whatever?
Yeah. It's almost like some weird Scientology-looking book.
Sure.
So, and if you're offended by that, then... look at the book cover. It's really weird. So tell me about Mastery and Robert Greene and why this book is like, it's like one of those books, Jeff, that's never on sale. Like you're never going to, it's always $19 or $27. Yeah. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So you're like, it must be good because there's a high point of entry. So why is it so good?
So Robert Greene is this author whom I've interviewed on the show before. So, you know, you can go back to the archives and listen to that if you want. But he's this, you know, internationally best-selling author who wrote this book about why you should be great at your craft, not just good. And I like this book because I think it's a little bit counterintuitive to a lot of books that, you know, you might find on, you know, like a business or self-improvement bookshelf these days, which is, you know, everybody's talking about success and you know, like how to, you know, beat out your competitors and how to make more money and, you know, do great things. And that's, you know, those things are fine. But this is a book that's really just about the craft. Like, here's why you need to care about what you do and care about being the best in your industry. And the basic thesis is that if you're great at what you do, the money will come, the fame will come, all these things that we tend to kind of put before the skill itself, all that stuff comes naturally as a byproduct of being the best at whatever it is that you do. And so basically the book is a series of biographies of, you know, masters of their craft, both, you know, in terms of like historical references as well as contemporary people. And it's a great read. It's very interesting. You know, it's you know, a lot of biographical stuff, so it might not be approachable for everybody. But I love the different concepts that Greene talks about. He talks about, I think, three phases. He talks about I'm going to get this wrong now, but he talks about kind of like the preparation phase, then the apprenticeship phase, which I love that word, that every master of their craft went through a period of time, usually 10 years, of intentional practice, and then they're not masters yet, and then they have what he calls the creative active phase, which is where they're, you know, they're professionally practicing their craft and you know, achieving greatness. And
he calls it your life's task.
Yeah, he calls it your life's task. I like to think of it as your calling. It's the thing that you were born to do, and it's a fascinating book.
And that's episode 12 of Portfolio Life, so you can find that. interview, but worth every penny apparently. So I need to suck it up and buy the book. So this is where it gets fun because we get into the commentary part of this because we're going to talk about some, you know, everybody wants to create timeless content, right, with their shows. But the bottom line is I love hearing people give commentary about news. So this news here is that Amazon has created the ability for you to make your Kindle books available for pre-order. So, and I think you can do it up to 90 days before your book goes out. You can't, of course, my first thought is, can I do this to my book now? Can I pull it off and like create some hype? And you can. It has to be a new book. But wow. Just real quick, it says, you can make your new books available for pre-order on Kindle stores worldwide. Setting a pre-order allows customers to order your book as early as 90 days before your book's release date. When you make your book available for pre-order, customers can order the book anytime leading up to the release date you set, and it will be delivered to them on that date. One advantage of pre-order is that you can start promoting your book before launch to help raise awareness. Author Central, Goodreads, your own site, and elsewhere. Pre-orders will contribute towards sales rank of other Kindle store merchandise before your book is released. So it doesn't say that there's a lot of difference other than in step four, it says select your book release option. And one of the things you can choose is make my book available for pre-order. And then you set your date in the future, and then that's it. And then I think that you get paid on that day. I don't think they actually get charged for it until that day of release. What do you think?
Well, this is a game changer. So maybe if you're not an author or aspiring author, you don't care about this. But for writers who want to publish a book someday, which you know we know through research is you know 8 out of 10 people at least say that they want to publish a book at some point. So the two of you, you know, the 20% of you that don't care about this, you know, I guess you can just, you know, go watch some cat videos on YouTube
or
something.
Yeah, but hang out because we've got some more stuff.
That's right. This is a game changer. I mean, this was contrasting self-publishing to traditional publishing. This was a tool in the toolkit of traditional publishers that, you know, made self-publishing a little less legitimate than traditional publishers.
Yeah.
So, I mean, now you can put a book on Kindle or on, you know, CreateSpace, which are the self-publishing platforms for authors on Amazon, and you can have pre-orders for 3 months and basically rack up all of those sales so that when your book comes out, it all hits, you know, Amazon bestsellers, you know, rank, all of those different lists that, you know, can contribute to future sales. And knowing this as a previously self-published author, and you should, you know this too, Andy, you basically had to drum up all of that attention, you know, somewhere else, you know, on an email list or something. And then when your book came out, point everybody to that book the first week it came out and hope that enough people bought that, you know, it made a splash, you know, that it attracted enough people to the book that more people bought it. I mean, this is kind of the beauty of Amazon. If you can get lots of people to buy your book, it climbs the bestsellers list, and there's lots of different bestsellers lists on Amazon, and then more people will discover it. Amazon will start referring it to other people who buy similar books, you know, that whole thing. Now you've got an advantage where you don't have to do that all the first week or the first month and hope it works. You can do it 3 months in advance and, you know, kind of harness all that energy on the opening week. So, you know, if you get, say, you know, 25 people to buy your book every week, you know, now you've got 300 sales that all count on the first week, plus whoever buys, you know, that week, you know, in addition to the pre-orders.
Yeah.
That's pretty awesome.
Well, and I know that I've seen it all come all the way down to this, where people will say, "Please buy the book between 10 and noon on day central." And you know, I get it. Like, I get why they're doing that. They're trying to get momentum. Mm-hmm. It makes sense. They're not gaming the system; they're participating in the system, right?
Right.
But now, Amazon has effectively said, "Hey! Just don't worry about it. Just you got 90 days."
So. You know? Here's a follow-up question to you, Andy. There's been a lot of controversy about Amazon essentially, you know, controlling a lot of the, you know, digital publishing world and even kind of encroaching on, you know, the traditional publishing world. And there's, you know, this big, you know, debate with Hachette. And I'll admit that I don't completely understand everything, but the basis of the argument, I think, is do publishers And authors reserve the right to price their books however they want, or, you know, does the bookstore, in this case Amazon, which they're really trying to control ebooks, you know, price from 99 cents to $9.99. So here's, you know, what we're talking about here is, man, like, Amazon is helping out self-published authors, but on the other side, a lot of people are saying this isn't fair what they're doing. They're controlling, you know, the pricing. What do you think about that?
You know, I just thought just came to my mind, in part because they're in the news, but like Dollar General is looking to buy some other real discount store. I don't remember what the other one is, but it's
Amazon. They're going to buy Amazon.
Right. No, what's crazy, those are like billion-dollar companies, like Dollar General and stuff, but they're looking at buying some other. And it's not that everything there is a dollar, but it's, you know, it's generally around a dollar. Maybe that's the name.
Generally.
Mm-hmm. But here's the thing, like, you don't go into the dollar store and expect something to be, like, I'm thinking of the literal dollar store, and go, I want to sell this. Well, how much does it cost? It's $5. Sir, everything here is a dollar. Well, I want to sell it for $5. Then you can't sell it here. Well, that's not fair. Like, well, no, we're the dollar store. Like, we set the rules. Mm-hmm. And as much as, because I think people really look at Amazon and they look at it like, well, no, this is like public property. And I go, no, it's not public property. It's a business.
It's a bookstore.
They can set the rules. Like, for those who, I was looking around this morning because a lady, Lisa Whittle, anyway, she wrote a post about Mark Driscoll, not directly, but this pastor that's a bunch of controversy lately. And 180 bookstores just took out his book. Took it off the shelves. Lifeway Books took his book off the shelf. Now, are they allowed to do that? Well, of course they are. It's their shelves. They pay rent. They bought the shelves, literally. You know, they pay rent. They can put whatever. And it's interesting to me, unless they're going back on earlier contracts they have, contractual agreements, that we somehow believe we have the right to tell them what they can and cannot price or carry. Now, if they're breaking contracts, that's a problem. Mm-hmm. You know, but that's how I view it is, do I like it? Does it seem like Amazon's kind of trying to push their weight around? Yeah, that's how they stay in business. So what are your thoughts? And then we'll do two quick little fun things and we'll wrap up.
Sure. Well, just to give the listeners a sense of how polished this show is, Andy just sent me a note about how this doesn't apply to Create Space as far as we can tell. So I don't know if this ever has happened before. Maybe I'm doing an on-air retraction of something I said 3 minutes ago, which is that this only applies right now to digital books as far as we know.
But Create it's still awesome.
Create Space is the print on demand, you know, Amazon, you know, publishing service. Yeah, pretty amazing.
And what are your thoughts on Amazon?
Yeah, so I like your, you know, the business side of it. I think that's interesting. My brain didn't even go there. I was just thinking in terms of readers. Now, I think that there's a lot of people, a lot of indie authors and even traditionally published authors kind of, you know, raising a stink saying, you can't do this. I don't know. Like, first of all, like as you said, I wouldn't walk into Barnes & Noble and go, you can't price my book at $11.99. The cover says $13.99. How dare you? Second of all, what we should really be caring about as authors is readers. And so Amazon isn't looking out for authors. Let's just be honest. I mean, this Create Space and pre-order thing is interesting with the digital books, but they're looking out for readers because those are their customers. And yeah, I get it. You know, indie authors are bringing a lot of readers to Amazon, and so there should be some synergy and cooperation there. That's a very valid point. But for me, when I started out as a writer, I never intended to make a living off of my books because I didn't want that pressure. Now, I like people buying my books. I like, you know, making money off of that. But my goal was never to just, you know, try to sell as many books as possible so that I could feed my family. My goal was to spread ideas, to get these stories and ideas into as many places as possible, which is why I've sometimes given away my books. It's why I use these words that I've written to help these ideas spread, which lead to, you know, other forms of income down the line. I'm not saying you have to be a starving artist. I am saying that the most generous artists, the most generous authors, content creators tend to be the ones who aren't lacking. And I think that if we see, you know, the market shrinking, or we see, you know, less money, you know, coming into our pockets and mm-hmm. prices going down, and we start mm-hmm. to get anxious, the best way we can respond to that is not with a scarcity mindset, but with an abundance mindset. And Amazon sent out an interesting update. I'm not necessarily pro Amazon, but I thought this was interesting, with some facts and figures about the difference between an $11.99, they pulled this from their data, like an $11.99 ebook versus the $9.99 ebook. Yep. And the $9.99 price point actually sells substantially more copies, that the author ends up making more money. Now, I just think that's an interesting principle in terms of abundance and scarcity. We authors, we content creators, or whatever it is that you do, if you make something for an end user, a customer, your goal shouldn't be to sell as many widgets as possible at, you know, the ideal price point. Your goal should be to do what's best for the customer. And if you do that, you're going to be okay too. I believe that. So that's what I think about it.
Absolutely. So here's the fun is, and I don't know if you're prepared for this at all, my friend, but you have to be prepared now. Because it's go time. The fourth P is practical personal growth publishing. We just talked about publishing. Now we're going to ask for something profound.
I will put my profound
get your hat on. Take your headphones
on.
Cap. Yeah. Sorry.
Cap. Well, so this has been sort of a writing episode. Not every episode is this way, but you know, as a writer, I do like talking about, you know, the craft a lot. And so, you know, I recently published this article about how, you know, why writing every day isn't just good for your writing, it's good for your life. Mm-hmm. And I read some interesting, you know, studies on this. One was like a psychology study about how just daily journaling can actually make you smarter. And this was important. You had to write by hand, and it talks about why like cursive writing, like increases cognitive.
And cursive?
It increases cognitive activity in ways that typing doesn't. It was pretty interesting.
Cursive.
So here's my profound thought. Writing every day doesn't just make me a better writer, it makes me a better person. And the reasons that I shared were, it makes me more disciplined, which we talked about. It can make you smarter, at least makes you more introspective, you know, a better thinker. And I think it gives you confidence. It gives you a sense that you accomplished something. And as we said before, discipline begets more discipline. It makes you stronger at the things that you're doing, and it also makes you stronger at lots of other things. Once you've become disciplined in a certain area of life, you can apply that to another area. And so, you know, all that comes together in a way that I think is, you know, kind of interesting, where, you know, somebody asked me, what should I write about? And I think that if you're solely focused on the thing itself, on the writing, on the creation, then you're going to miss the mark. The well is going to, you know, run dry. But if you're living a good life and you're doing things outside of the writing, that's going to inspire the writing itself. And so I have sort of this, you know, idea that, you know, good writing inspires great living, you know, makes for a better life, makes you a better person, and great living inspires better writing.
Cursive? All right, next part is
take it or leave it.
Prediction. You got to make a prediction.
Uh-huh.
It can be completely ridiculous, or it can border on the profound, since it's right to the end. But I thought prediction would be fun to end with. So
I predict – okay, so this is somewhat inspired by another friend's podcast. My friend Brian Elaine had me on his podcast recently. It's called the Schnoz Cast, and if you see a picture of Brian, you might know why it's called that. And we were talking about a bunch of different things, but one of the things we talked about was dictionaries. And for those of you who missed it, there are several articles in the news about how the word literally now is used interchangeably with figuratively in the dictionary. So if anybody has ever, you know, heard this, especially I think from younger people, they'll say, man, like my face literally melted off when I heard that electric guitar solo. And they're using it for emphasis, but if you buy an older dictionary, you will know that the word literal means like something that actually happened that way. I don't even know of another way to say it other than literally. But now people have misused literally so much that it is used interchangeably with figuratively, which means you can use it, you know, hyperbolically. You can use it for emphasis to exaggerate.
You just broke a rule. You cannot use a word to define another word that people don't understand.
Okay, sorry. You can use it to exaggerate.
Okay.
So here's my prediction. If we look at Wikipedia, right? Encyclopedias, like who buys encyclopedias anymore? Who sells encyclopedias anymore?
God
doesn't
bless them.
Doesn't really happen. Same thing is going to happen with dictionaries, where I don't think we've seen this yet, where you're going to have an open source online dictionary. And I think we're going to see in this next, you know, I don't know, 10, 20 years, you're going to see language, you know, and I don't know if this is a good thing or a bad thing, but I think it's already starting to happen, which is that you're going to see the masses in ways that has never been done before, you know, it's been done before, but it hasn't been done to this magnitude. You know, mass culture has always influenced language.
Sure.
You know, like the word normalcy didn't exist before a president started using it. And so who knows what kind of words we'll have in 25 years after experiencing the lexicon of George W. Bush. But I think dictionaries are going to go away and they're going to be replaced by online open source dictionaries. That's my prediction.
Wow, that's much more profound than mine. Good. Good. I'm glad we did yours.
What's your prediction?
Oh, thank you for asking. Now I can sound and feel dumber than I already did. No, I was at Dunkin' Donuts this morning, and my prediction was that they would have better growth than Starbucks in the next 3 years. Because
interesting,
I was like, well, for one of the things that I think will drive them, and this is going to hurt my friend's feeling who actually works on the Starbucks app, is like they're very aggressive with their couponing on their app. Like they have a good Dunkin' Donuts has a good app, and like they're consistently going, hey, here's this like. So I was going to say they give away donuts like candy because they are like candy. They give away donuts like donuts. But yeah, I mean, they're doing all kinds of fancy stuff. But yeah, that's my prediction. Dunkin' Donuts growth is going to do very well. And they're actually putting pressure on Starbucks, which who would have thought that like 15 years ago? You know, like Starbucks, Dunkin' Donuts, definitely head-to-head competition I see going on there. You know, like
yeah,
that's
right.
Like clown car and Porsche. I definitely see those going head-to-head.
Well, the reality is Dunkin' Donuts has really stepped up their game with their coffee. I mean, some people don't realize that, but they've got pretty good coffee now. I would say it competes with Starbucks. And if you think that's heresy, let us know in a review on iTunes.
This would be a great show if not for, you know. Yeah. That's a good reason to give a one-star review, the Dunkin' Donuts comment. So, Jeff, I hope this didn't suck.
I hope not also. Neither. Yes.
Way to end on a good literary tone there.
Yeah.
We'll go back and edit that out. No, we won't. Okay. We'll leave it in. Hey, this has been the Portfolio Life. We would appreciate you heading over to iTunes or just leave a comment on the post in Jeff's site at coinswriter.com and say, hey, guys, nice try, but don't do that again. Or, hey, fellas, that was rockin', or whatever the kids say. And won't you roll the dice so I can know? Hey, thanks for spending part of your day with us. To leave a tip on how you build habits or master a skill or your thoughts on the future of Dunkin' Donuts, you can find this episode at goinswriter.com. And if we've brought any measure of joy to your life today, will you return that favor and leave us a review on iTunes? Because reviews on iTunes bring us joy. They bring joy to our lives. And they also help other people find the show. And because you're so kind and fairly compliant, let me just say thank you in advance for leaving that review. Thank you.
If you're solely focused on the thing itself, on the writing, on the creation, then you're going to miss the mark. The well is going to, you know, run dry. But if you're living a good life and you're doing things outside of the writing, that's going to